Aujourd'hui, je vous demande d'accueillir deux grands réalisateurs, Costa Gavras et John Landis. Merci d'être avec nous aujourd'hui. Thank you for being with us today. I know you have a very busy schedule. Et comme je vous le disais, on va commencer par vous, Costa, puisque c'est vrai que c'est un peu inhabituel. Vos cinémas, si je puis dire, sont très différents. Et pourtant, vous êtes là par amitié, je sais, pour John, et aussi parce que vous aimez son cinéma. Dites-nous un peu comment, pourquoi vous vous êtes rencontrés et pourquoi vous êtes là aujourd'hui. Ça y est, John, vous allez, ça y est, vous êtes immortalisé par John Landis. That have become part of your next movie, maybe. Who knows? If you're doing a documentary in France, that's your chance. Alors.
Non, d'abord, nous sommes, comme vous l'avez dit, nous sommes des amis, mais nous sommes devenus amis par le cinéma, naturellement. J'aime beaucoup son cinéma. Et quand je travaillais à Los Angeles, un des patrons de l'Universal me l'a présenté un jour, parce que j'avais dit que j'aimais son cinéma. Et j'ai découvert un homme qui connaît le cinéma parfaitement. Il connaît pas seulement les metteurs en scène et les auteurs, il connaît les petits rôles. Et je vais vous dire, je l'ai vérifié encore ce matin, quand je l'ai présenté à la Cinémathèque, enfin, je lui fais traverser l'exposition Kubrick. Il me disait, ça c'est un tel, les petits rôles comme ça. Il m'a appris des choses sur l'exposition que je connais très bien, mais que je ne connaissais pas. Donc c'est qu'il m'a beaucoup surpris. Il connaît très bien le cinéma français aussi. Et je peux dire que c'est un des rares à Los Angeles qui connaît aussi bien le cinéma d'une manière générale et d'une manière en profondeur, et pas que le cinéma américain.
I have to say something about Costa.
Ah, voilà, il doit dire qu'un truc.
Because I know Costa many years, and it's fun for me in France, well, in America, wherever you are, because Costa is so respected, and everybody's so serious with Costa. It's like, oh, Monsieur Gavras, Costa Gavras. It's like, and he's so funny. He's really funny, but it's like a secret. It's like he's really funny, but it's like when you're in Paris, these people are like, oh, Monsieur Gavras, and it's like that. And I'm thinking, do they know him? Because he's really funny, and he's you know, also he's one of the great filmmakers, one of the really great and important filmmakers.
Edinburgh, 1828. The greatest minds came from all over the world. And so did these guys.
We've got no money to speak of. No plan.
We just have to work out what the demand is for, and then supply it.
Within every cloud, there's a silver lining.
Alors, vous savez que ça fait quand même 12 ans que John Landis n'a pas tourné pour le cinéma. Donc, ma première question sera évidemment, pourquoi une si longue absence? Est-ce que ça lui a manqué?
Moi j'aurais une, une question à John que ça peut vous intéresser aussi. Comment tu as commencé? How did you start?
Alors on va revenir à ses débuts. Alors, on vient à ses débuts.
In the cinema.
In the cinema?
Yeah.
Why the cinema and not the banking, for example?
That's my mother wants to know that. When I was 8 years old, I saw a movie on at the Crest Theater on Westwood Boulevard, which is still there. Called Seventh Voyage of Sinbad. And there's an expression in literature called suspension of disbelief, which is what suspension of disbelief means. Any painting or book or piece of theater, anything that works for you, that really, it means that you are transported, that you have no disbelief, you believe it, you're there, you experience it. And I had that when I was eight with Seventh Voyage of Sinbad. And I went home and I asked my mother, I said, and I remember it very well because I had looking up at my mother. I said, who does that? Who makes that? Who makes movies? And she said, the director.
Entre 8 ans et 21 ans, parce qu'il a fait son premier film à 21 ans, c'est pas habituel. Hein?
I grew up in Los Angeles and I had no relatives in the film business, unfortunately, because I wish I did. But in Los Angeles, you have to remember cinema, film, is very young. It's about 120 years old. So that means that I was born in 1950. So when I was a kid, when I was especially a teenager, many people, in fact, most of the people who invented the language were still alive and a lot of them working. So when I was 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, I went out and I made a point of meeting them. So I went out And because I was in L.A., I could meet, you know, Frank Capra, Howard Hawks, George Stevens, Don Siegel, everybody.
We used to sell to Dr. Knox at £3 a cadaver.
£3?
And I thought life around here was supposed to be cheap.
This is wrong.
I am confident that this is the only way.
I had confidence in a fart once, and I shot all over myself.
I commend you both on account of his freshness.
I'll give you £3.
I'll pay you the same for any more you can deliver.
What do you do for a living?
In surgical supplies.
You do?
I became a dancer, and times got tough, and I branched out into physical theater.
Yeah, like acrobatics.
Sometimes.
People make movies, everybody, for many different reasons. I have made movies for money. Absolutely, because they say, we'll pay you this much money. Really? Okay. I've made movies for passion, and I've made movies for out of perversity, truthfully, to be subversive. But you make movies for many different reasons. And it's interesting because when they say, what are the themes of your movies? What is it? Honestly, I don't think that's my job. That's your job, but that's a critic's job. Because I know I'll see a friend. I have a lot of friends who are filmmakers all over the world. Japanese, Spanish, French, Mexican, you name it. I have Germans. I know a lot of people. Because I like filmmakers and I seek them out. And sometimes you'll see a movie by a friend. I'll tell you a true story. Many years ago, Universal Studios were releasing two horror pictures. One was called... Jesus Christ, what the fuck was it? Oh, Video, David Cronenberg's film, Videodrome. And the other was John Carpenter's film, The Thing. And they had released An American Werewolf in London about a year, almost a year before. So as a promotion, they did a thing with Mick Garris, who was a publicist, he's now a director, where they had David Cronenberg, John Landis, John Carpenter, talk about these films. It was really a commercial. But David Cronenberg and John Carpenter are two very smart guys. They're very smart. And we're talking about the movies and censorship and things like that. And Mick is asking questions. And there was a moment when Mick asked John Carpenter, he said, John, in Halloween, which started all the slasher movies, he said, in Halloween, why is it that all the girls who are topless and have sex are horribly murdered? And Jamie Lee Curtis, who's the only one who's virgin and keeps her clothes on, she lives. And he looked at Mick, and he looked at me, and I realized it never occurred to him. And he was horrified. He was so upset, he didn't know what to say. He was like, oh, fuck me. He couldn't believe it. It was an amazing moment, And then David saved him because David went, well, in Toronto, where I grew up, in my school, all the girls who showed their tits were killed. And I immediately said, yes. And in Los Angeles, all the girls who are topless are immediately killed. And, it became a joke and ha ha ha. And we changed it. But there was an amazing moment when John thought, he was shocked. So some filmmakers don't always know what they're putting in the movies. It's a lot of it is subconscious.
Sex. Murder.
Are you all right?
We're talking about the ultimate crowd pleaser.
The militia. They're closing in.
All right, wait. Show me your wounds. I think you got a perfectly lovely arse.
Even Mrs. McPhee?
I don't think painting or sculpture or music or theater is art. I think painting, music, sculpture, theater can be art and often is art. But I don't think that the media is art. And film is a craft like carpentry. So if you give six carpenters the same material, here's wood, here's nails, here's a hammer and saw, make a chair. All of them will make a chair. You can sit on it, it's a chair. One of those chairs might be like a Charles Eames or a Chippendale. One of those chairs might be art. But you don't have to be an artist to make a chair. You just have to know how to make a chair.
Je vais prolonger sa théorie. John dit, nous en France, nous sommes, c'est ce qu'il vient de dire, quand on fait un cinéma, c'est-à-dire un craftsman, un artisan. vous, et nous faisons des chaises. Et une de ces chaises peut devenir, comme il a dit, une œuvre artistique. Vous, en France, quand vous faites un film, vous vous dites au départ, je vais faire une œuvre artistique. Et c'est ça, enfin, d'après lui, je crois qu'il est assez près de la vérité. Vous, vous commencez par dire, je vais faire une œuvre artistique. Et après, ça peut l'être ou ça peut ne pas l'être. Et il est vrai que très souvent, ça ne l'est pas.
Do you know, in English, there's a word, in English, there's a word pretentious. Do you know the word pretentious?
Well, it's prétentieux in French.
All right. So I think this is a ridiculous word. It's a stupid word. Because you know what it means? It means you failed. That's what it means. Because if it worked, people go, oh. If it fails, they go, oh, he's being pretentious.
Well, I'm pretty sure tonight's the night.
I know this amazing trick you can do with your tongue.
Thank you, William.
I am Captain McClintock, and this is the Edinburgh Militia.
Oh, for the love of Lord Jesus!
I beg your pardon.
Burke and Hare.
What about his posture, sir?
Threaten him out.